Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Melanie Paris, and I'm the Senior Director of Health Initiatives and Education here at the American Kidney Fund. Before I turn the presentation over to today's speaker, I'd like to direct your attention to the control panel you should see on your screens. All participants are on mute, so we won't hear you, but we welcome your questions. If you have a question, please type it into the section of your control panel titled Questions. We'll see your questions and we'll do our best to answer them either by replying to you in the questions box or out loud during the last several minutes of the presentation. This webinar is being recorded and will be available for viewing on our website, kidneyfund.org/webinars, within the next 1 to 2 weeks. For those of you in attendance who are health professionals, we're glad that you've joined us today and hope you'll recommend this webinar to the patients you work with. However, as a friendly reminder, this webinar is not accredited for continuing education credits. If you believe that your accrediting body may offer you credits for attending this webinar, we'll be happy to send you a certificate of attendance after today's session. Simply email us at education@kidneyfund.org. Without further ado, allow me to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Sagar Negwakar. Dr. Sagar Negwakar is an assistant professor of medicine at the Harvard Medical School and an assistant physician at the Massachusetts General Hospital. Dr. Negwakar received his medical degree from the University of Mumbai in India and master's in medical sciences degree from the Harvard Medical School. He trained in nephrology at Brigham and Women's Hospital, Massachusetts General Hospital's Joint Nephrology Fellowship Program. Dr. Negwakar is co-author of the book, Top 5 Questions to Ask Your Doctor, and has special interest in improving communication between patients and their healthcare providers. His research interests include kidney disease-related cardiovascular complications and kidney stones. Dr. Negwakar has authored more than 60 peer-reviewed research articles in high-impact journals and has been a prior recipient of Young Investigator Award from the National Kidney Foundation and Clinical Scientist in Nephrology Award from the American Kidney Fund. Dr. Negwakar enjoys traveling, skiing, and kayaking. He lives in Cambridge, Massachusetts with his wife and 7-year-old daughter. Thank you, Dr. Negwakar, for joining us.
Thank you, Melanie, and let me extend a welcome to all the attendees to this webinar. Let me also take this opportunity to thank the organizers to invite me to share my thoughts on communication with doctors and also support from the American Kidney Fund over the years in terms of my research interests in as we improve the quality of life as well as outcomes in patients who have kidney disease. So I got interested in this particular topic when I became a patient and quickly realized that despite having medical training, still it when the time came to interface with a medical provider, how ill trained or equipped I was considering the constraints of time, the complexities of the medical system, so on and so forth. So that actually inspired my interest and remains to be an active interest as I see this with my own health as well as with my family members' health, and of course the patients, as I see the struggle and the tension between the provider and the patient as it relates to those challenges of time and the complexity of the system. It's probably not a surprise to most attendees that as the time has gone by, the complexity of the healthcare system has only gotten worse. And at the same time, the time that the doctor or a healthcare provider spends with a patient in terms of actual communication has reduced, and that has resulted in some of these many actually complications, but some of these are also highlighted in a lighthearted fashion in a cartoon that you see on your slide, where a comment is made that yes, the doctor will see you now, but I can't really promise that he will talk to you, but he will see you. And I'm sure, you know, patients and family members frequently are in the healthcare offices or hospitals where it seems like the doctors are mostly talking to the computers and not really engaging in terms of really having a quality communication with a patient or the or their family member. So with that in the background, the way I thought I will conduct today's discussion, if we go to the next slide, is to just give you first of all an overview of what we will discuss in the next 40 minutes or so, and then of course we'll give you opportunities to ask ask questions. So as Melanie mentioned, when I was in my when I was doing my chief residency in internal medicine, I got together with a physician's assistant who was part of our practice, and he and I, we kind of sat down and wrote a book to guide patients as they interface with their healthcare providers. And most of the focus of that book was about patients who are seen in the primary care setting. So I will kind of share some parts from that book as it relates to some general advices or tips as we talk to our doctors, some questions that should be considered at doctor's visit, some information that you may want to bring up in your communication with the doctors as it relates to the medications that that patient is taking, also, you know, issues that are pertinent when somebody's in the hospital, because that's now a different setting than the outpatient setting. And again, the way the system is now is designed, most primary care physicians do not follow patients in the hospital on a day-to-day basis. They may be involved in terms of communication from the hospital physicians and just getting an update about a particular patient, but these physicians may not be may not see the patient on a daily basis and may not be the primary decision makers when somebody is hospitalized, which is a kind of a paradigm shift. And from the patient's perspective, it kind of gets quite confusing, because a physician that they are seeing for many months or years in the office setting, suddenly when they're sick and now admitted in the hospital, is no longer the physician in charge for their care. At the time when they're kind of sick or ill and need somebody who has that longitudinal perspective about their health. And I'm not saying that the primary care physician is not completely involved, but it's not the same thing when in the older system, the primary care physician used to actually come to the hospital and see the patient on a daily basis and was used to be the prescribing provider. And those days are almost gone from all major healthcare systems. And now there's a system known as hospitalist system, where the hospital employed physician is in charge of the patients when they're in the hospital. And that physician is supposed to be in communication with the patient's primary care physician. But from the patient's perspective, many a times that comes as a big big surprise and a shock, and can be actually a source of fragmented healthcare. So I'll kind of share with you some tips in terms of how to optimize that that transitions of care from the outpatient to the hospital, and then of course back from the hospital to the outpatient setting. And then some specific tips about what to think about in terms of communicating with the doctor when somebody is scheduled for a procedure or a surgery. And although it's not part of this overview, I will also, being a nephrologist, and I understand American Kidney Fund, of course, does a lot of work for patients who have kidney disease and on behalf of their families. So I will also include some specific questions as they relate to conditions that we frequently take care of in the kidney perspective, meaning high blood pressure, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, dialysis, or kidney stones. So we'll spend some time on those conditions towards the end. Next slide, please. Okay, so some general tips in terms of communication with the healthcare provider. I think, first of all, knowing the system and just kind of having an organized approach does help in optimizing these communications and also getting the most out of the limited time that you are going to have with your doctor. In my office setting, for example, it's a specialty practice focused on in nephrology, and the way our practice is set is a new patient appointment is typically a 30-minute appointment. So patient is going to have 30 minutes for the visit, and not all of that time will be necessarily spent with the doctor. Of course, when the patient comes in, initially they will be assessed by either a nurse or a technician who will take some measurements like blood pressure, weight, heart rate, and then the patient will be placed in one of the doctor's office rooms. So as you can imagine, you know, the time 30 minutes to begin with seems quite limited, and then plus there are other things that have to happen before a doctor sees the patient, so that further constrains the time that a patient is going to have with their doctor. So as you are I guess scheduled to see a provider, having a clear agenda is important. So if it's going to be a new visit, it's good to know what is the reason for that visit. And again, in a specialty practice such as ourselves, patients are referred to us by their primary care providers, typically with a specific question or a specific concern. So it may be something like your blood pressure is not well controlled, or it may be something like your creatinine, which is a marker of kidney function, is worsening, and the primary care physician is looking for some guidance from the specialist for those particular issues. So it's not infrequent, though, many a times, it's not infrequent that I will see patients in the office, but they will not have any information or insight into why they are there. And then it's one thing if it's the, if the medical records are available at the time of evaluation of that patient, yes, the doctor can quickly go through those records and decide or at least conclude what the patient is there for. But if those are not readily available, and if the patient is also not clear about why he or she is there, then that just introduces another barrier and burden on that limited time that the doctor is going to spend with the patient. So I think I always encourage, my office actually encourages the patients to know well in advance to kind of find out why they will be seen by a doctor. And in fact, many a times we have been able to kind of direct the consults to the right specialty service and avoid putting the extra burden of the visit on a patient or the family. For example, I'll give you a scenario. So I'm a nephrologist, so I deal with kidney problems, but on the medical side, and there is a specialty known as urology, and those doctors also deal with kidneys, but they are on the surgical side. And many a times referrals are made by the primary care physicians to a nephrologist for a problem such as suspicious kidney tumor. Now, yes, I'm a kidney specialist, but that kidney tumor problem is actually typically managed by the urologist. So in that regard, you know, it's good to know. And if the patient voices that either at the time of making an appointment or if the records are sent, and if we know that that's the reason for referral, then of course we can direct that to the right service and avoid the in-person visit for that patient. So I think my point is, you know, the patient should make some effort and try to understand what is the reason for his or her visit, and then accordingly set up the agenda. And of course, this is for a new patient, but if somebody is going to be seen for a follow-up, then those can be, in broadly speaking, of two types. One is, you know, there is a follow-up set up as an urgent follow-up because something specific is abnormal and has to be addressed pretty urgently. But most follow-ups are like general or routine follow-ups where patients come maybe every few months or maybe every year to get certain routine tests done, either by a primary care physician or by a specialty physician. So again, knowing that well in advance helps for doctors also to focus the visit accordingly. If the patient's primary focus is going to be some specific symptom or a sign that he or she has noticed, then that should be put on the table right in the beginning of the visit, so that you're not left at the end of the meeting with the doctor without addressing whatever is the primary concern was. I really like or encourage my patients to bring somebody with them, a family member or a friend who can be there in the room when the doctor is communicating with the patient, and that helps in multiple ways, including just having another set of ears. This person is not typically as anxious as the patient is, and so is able to register things and is able to also ask questions and advocate on behalf of the patient. So we really like it that the patient will bring somebody with him or her to the doctor's visit. And then lastly, in terms of some general tips for conversations, I think having a few questions ready to ask your physician also helps in terms of enhancing that communication, and more importantly, avoids the follow-up phone calls or follow-up communication with the doctor's office. And I understand, and in fact, I hear quite frequently, unfortunately, from patients even at our practice, that getting hold of the provider can be quite challenging. If phone lines are frequently busy, phone messages sometimes may get lost. So in that regard, I would say it's a good idea to also inquire with the doctor's office what other, in addition to the, of course, traditional phone numbers, do they also have other tools that will facilitate the communication between the patient and the physician. And those tools can be electronic portals, like our practice now actually offers something known as a patient gateway, where a patient can log in using a secure user ID as well as the password, and then can submit questions, can review the results of the recent tests, can communicate with the practice, including the doctor, through that portal. And actually, that does help tremendously in terms of improving the efficiency of the system and also avoiding issues such as the busy telephone lines and messages getting lost in the phone queue. So inquiring about what specifically is available, and most practices now do offer some kind of electronic way to engage with the system. So that has actually helped quite a bit, I think, both from the physician side and also from the patient side. So when I'm communicating with my doctor, I am actually primarily relying on the patient gateway type of a portal, through which I submit my questions to my provider. I engage with the nurse at my doctor's practice for things like medication renewals or scheduling different tests. I also get my flu shot and other appointments through that portal. So that has actually introduced quite a bit of efficiency in the system, and specifically I have been benefited through that electronic communication. Next slide. So this is I would say some top questions that I thought will be most pertinent as you are planning a visit with your doctor. And these are kind of, I would say, generic questions that apply to most conditions and treatments. So of course, as part of the doctor's visit, it's very likely that a patient leaves the practice with a new prescription for a medication or a supplement. And then the question is, one question that is worth asking is what exactly will be the marker to suggest that a specific treatment is working. Sometimes doctors will prescribe treatments for a specific symptom or a sign, but also sometimes these treatments are prescribed for an abnormality in a blood marker or a urine marker. So patient may start a treatment, but may or may not notice any change in the symptoms. And if the patient is, you know, under the impression that, you know, the outcome that they are monitoring is a symptom, then of course that's not going to change. The patient may feel that a given treatment is not really effective. But in reality, it may be, because maybe it did change some of the blood test parameters. A classic example may be a cholesterol lowering medication. Most of those medications, or most patients with high level of cholesterol do not actually have any symptoms from it. And a physician may decide to put a patient on a treatment for that condition, like a statin type of a treatment. And again, most patients who are taking statin may not have any symptoms from statin. But at the same time, the way physician will kind of interpret whether it is working or not is by doing a serial blood test. So having insight into what is going to be a tool to monitor a treatment is going to be important from the patient's perspective. It's, I think, well worth mentioning that although the treatments that are frequently prescribed are approved therapies for a given condition, but it's a well-known fact that not every treatment is going to be working in the same fashion in all patients. There is going to be some normal variation in terms of how an individual patient responds to a given treatment. And I think in that regard, it will be important to then know what is going to be monitored as a method, as a measure of effectiveness and also safety of a given treatment. And because if that treatment that is prescribed for a given condition is not working for that particular patient, then obviously that's important to know. And then maybe there needs to be a second line treatment that can be either added or substituted. I think also having a little bit of insight into what exactly is the given treatment or a medication going to do in terms of the condition is also important. So for example, this treatment is prescribed to lower my blood pressure, or this treatment is prescribed to improve my control of diabetes so that down the line, the diabetes may not affect my kidney as badly as it will in the absence of this treatment. So having a little bit of insight into why, what exactly is expected and how exactly this treatment is going to affect your condition also helps understand the disease process as well as the treatments better. And this also actually helps in your communication with other doctors. In the current practice schema that we have in the Western world, patients are frequently seen by multiple doctors. There is, of course, a primary care physician who is kind of the captain of the ship, but there are multiple specialists, and especially for patients who have complicated conditions, including advanced kidney disease or those who are on dialysis. They're frequently seeing many, many providers, and it's good for the patient to know why a given provider prescribed this treatment, so that when they communicate with another provider, that also helps that other provider to understand what was the indication for the other treatment. And of course, this communication regarding indication of a treatment between the providers should take place independent of patient's input. Ideally, it should be directly between the two specialists, or the specialist and the primary care physician, in terms of updating each other's for why they are prescribing a certain treatment. But again, the reality of the medical system is such that that communication is sometimes broken. And I think that's where the patient or their caregivers can be more, them being proactive actually helps ease that communication. It's also good to ask questions as they relate to, you know, what is your impression, doc, in terms of what is causing the symptom that I have or the sign that I have? Is there only one condition that is going on, or are you suspecting that there is more than one thing going on? Again, will make your physician also think in those lines, and also more importantly will improve your understanding of what is going on. You leave the doctor's office, and then, you know, you would like to know what will be some symptoms or the signs that for which you should contact the doctor's office again. Otherwise, doctor's offices may frequently tell you to come back after, you know, X number of days or weeks or months. And that is generally, you know, is what they expect will be a reasonable follow-up for a given condition and for a given patient. And most of the times they are right, but of course, you know, obviously the things can change and each patient is different. So I think from the patient's point of view, it's also important to know what kind of symptoms or signs they should be looking for as the clues for reaching back the physician's office, and maybe something that needs to be done more sooner than the scheduled follow-up visit. Next slide. So here, there are questions. Again, these are additional questions to consider as part of the visit. And of course, I understand that, you know, it's not all the questions, first of all, will not be applicable for all visits, but I'm just giving you a broad sense of things to consider as part of that question portfolio for your provider. I think it's not unreasonable to ask questions such as, can this condition be treated without actually taking a pill or without taking a specific medication? Is there anything I can change with my lifestyle that will achieve the same outcome, but at the same time will not expose me to the potential cost or the side effects of medication? So I think that's an important question to have. And there are a number of now actually lines of evidence available for things like exercise, of course, diet, calorie restriction, the low salt diet, moderation of the alcohol intake, and of course the smoking cessation. Many of these lifestyle changes have been really nicely shown to improve control of blood pressure, control of diabetes, preventing or delaying the progression of what we call chronic kidney disease. And these are all non-medication related treatments. So I think knowing those is also important. And frequently, you know, again, sometimes the time constraints push the doctors to kind of just prescribe a pill, because it's kind of faster to do that than to actually engage in a communication about lifestyle changes. But if the patient is involved and is motivated to do those things, then I think there should be more discussion about those lifestyle changes. And plus the benefits are obviously avoiding the cost and the adverse events of potentially from the medications. I think it's also important to understand whether the condition that you are seeing the patient, you're seeing the physician for, is it something temporary and a short-term condition, or is it something that's going to be long-term? And again, in my practice as a nephrologist, most conditions are actually long-term conditions. So hypertension, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, these are conditions that the patients are going to have for the rest of their life. And yes, there is going to be, you know, in many patients, a slow progression. It's not something that's going to be seen acutely. But I think from the patient's perspective also, it's important to know that so that, you know, they can frame their mind in terms of what to expect, how often to come for the visits, how often to check the blood tests, how often to check the urine tests. And maybe sometimes conditions are temporary. So in the kidney disease area, not so much in the outpatient setting, but in the inpatient setting, sometimes the kidney function gets worse acutely from the use of medications, or maybe from dehydration or something like that. And those conditions are typically temporary, meaning within a matter of days to weeks, the kidney function then comes back to its baseline. So it's also important to know whether that kind of condition, will it have any long-term implication, or is it just a one-time episode and no further follow-up issues are needed. Next slide. This slide actually lists some questions and opportunities for communications as they relate to medications that a physician is prescribing. So is the medication that a physician is considering, is it only available in a branded form, or is it also available in a generic form. And in general, of course, the generic forms are cheaper than the branded forms, and in many cases, quite comparable to the branded forms. But there are some unique situations where a physician may insist that a specific branded formulation should be used. And there are some very good reasons to do that, especially for certain medications, like medications that are used to treat, for example, seizure disorder. And those medications have different availability depending on the formulation. And obviously, the physician there insists on a specific brand because he or she knows that this brand is working for this patient. And if you just change the brand and go to a generic medicine, the absorption of that medication may not be adequate, and the patient may be left with the risk for seizures just because of change in the formulation. So those are some unique situations, but those are quite rare. For most conditions, the generic medicine will work just as well as the branded formulation. It will be, of course, much cheaper. Specific things about medications to know, and of course, there are a lot of new medications available now in the market for a variety of conditions, and it's great that the options are now available for the patients. But at the same time, there are a lot of nuances with these medications. Can they be taken with food, without food, because the food itself may interfere with the absorption of certain medications? Can they be taken with other medications? There are some medications that will block the absorption or the availability of the other medication. So they need to be spaced out so that the other medication absorption is not interfered with. Certain medications work better if they are taken in the morning, whereas certain medications work better if they are taken at night. So again, knowing that is important. And many a times these issues are discussed by the pharmacist when the medication is actually dispensed, but also having some inputs on this from a physician is also important, especially I think as it relates to issues of interaction with other medications, because the pharmacist may or may not have the full list of medications available when this issue is discussed. So the physician's office will have the whole list of medications and is able to guide you in terms of how this new medication is going to potentially interact with other medications. Of course, getting the questions about side effects and the potential risks of this medication is an important one. And there will be additional discussion about this also with the pharmacist when the medication is actually dispensed to the patient. Let's go to the next slide. Another question about medications is, certain medications need to be, if they are to be discontinued, they cannot be abruptly stopped because there could be a rebound phenomenon. The patient may kind of demonstrate the signs or symptoms of almost like a withdrawal if the medication is stopped suddenly. So it's important always to know what is the right way to stop or discontinue a certain medication, because patients may leave the doctor's office with a new medication, and if they think that this is causing not working or having some other issues, or maybe they run out of prescription, it may get stopped abruptly. And of course, knowing in advance that this is a medication that should not be stopped abruptly is important, because so that the patient is going to pay particular attention about things like not running out of that medication. If it has to be stopped for those medications, generally, a doctor will recommend a slow taper, meaning the dose may be initially reduced by maybe, let's say, 75%, and then 50%, and then 25%, and then all the way down to zero, but not kind of from 100% to 0%. Some medications interfere with activities of like physical activity, but also like mentation. And then it's good to know, are there going to be any restrictions in terms of driving, work, intake of alcohol when you're taking those medications? A question about, if I don't tolerate this particular medication, what will be my alternatives? Is there another medication from the same class that I can try? or can I try a medication from a different class? So this comes up quite a bit in our practice where we see patients with high blood pressure. And I, of course, being a specialist, see patients who have already been treated by their primary care physician for high blood pressure, but despite using two or three medications, the blood pressure is still high, and then they're referred to a specialist. So my advice to not infrequently to these patients is when they initially see us, we kind of go through their medication list and adjust some of those medications. And then as I'm doing that, I always have a discussion with them. Like, let's say if I'm prescribing you a medication known as a clonidine tablet, which is a very strong medication to reduce the blood pressure. But if the patient is not able to take that pill for whatever reason, or if that pill is going to interfere with other medications that the patient is on, then the alternative could be the clonidine is also available as a patch. It can be applied as a patch to the skin from where it can be absorbed and can be still effective as a medication to lower the blood pressure. So having these kind of alternatives available and discussed in the doctor's visit also kind of, I think, in general helps in terms of improving the care and eventually hopefully also the outcomes. Some other questions: what should I do if I miss a dose? There are certain medications where if you miss, you know, a dose, it's okay to just kind of take the next dose as scheduled. Whereas in some other medications case, the doctors will suggest that if you miss a dose, take the next one as soon as you find out that you have missed the dose and you have the next dose available. Where to store a medication? Can it be stored at room temperature, which most medications are? But then there are certain medications which, of course, have to be stored in a refrigerator. And that, again, knowing that and preparing for that in advance is important. Next slide. So now the next slide actually talks about what specifically to focus on when somebody is hospitalized. And as I discussed in the introductory comments, that in the current environment, it's very likely that when a patient is hospitalized, he or she may not see the primary care physician in the hospital, the physician that they are otherwise most familiar with, but they may see a hospital physician. They will likely see a hospital physician who, of course, is going to be in communication with the primary care physician. I know that I have been on the hospital medicine side also, and I know that it is not always practical and readily available, the information such as what are the medications that the patient is taking at home. So again, if the patient has a list of medications that he or she takes at home, and if that is shared, when the patient goes to the hospital or to the emergency room, that actually helps the doctors in terms of having that accurate information available and then planning the next step in terms of the emergency room evaluation and also the hospital evaluation. It's also good to know that some home medications that patient is taking as part of their prescriptions may not be available in the hospital, because the hospital pharmacies and the hospital formularies have some standard medications available for use in the hospital. So the patient's medication that he or she is taking at home may or may not be available in the exact same form in the hospital. And hospitals will frequently, you know, change that medication to what is available on their formulary. And again, in many cases, that will be completely fine, but in some situations it may not be. So knowing when you're in the hospital what you are getting treated with in the hospital as opposed to what you are getting at home is also important, and confirming with the hospital doctor that the medications that are now given in the hospital are kind of comparable to what you were taking at home. There, of course, will be very likely some new medications that you will get in the hospital for the condition that brought you to the hospital. But your regular medications will be frequently continued as your kind of long-term medications but they may be changed in terms of the exact formulation or the dose. And again, knowing that that conversion has taken place with good insight will be helpful. Many a times, some of the patients' regular medications get completely lost when they just get in the hospital, and subsequently the patients leave the hospital with a new medication list, and those previous medications are not on that list, and then patient is kind of confused whether to resume all those home medications that he or she was taking before the hospitalization or not. So I think having that communication with the physician and also with the nurse at the time of discharge is important. Also understanding after the hospitalization, who should I be following up with? Because it's not uncommon that in the hospital, there will be different doctors who will see you. Many doctors may see you. A surgeon may see, nephrologist may see, cardiologist may see, and then are you supposed to follow with all of them? Are you supposed to follow with one of them or none of them? Knowing that in advance is important. And of course, at the time of discharge, the hospital physician is the main person who you should be engaged with in terms of getting these answers, getting questions to these answers. But for some reason, if this was not discussed or any questions come after the hospitalization, then your primary care doctor will be your go-to person in terms of addressing these questions. Next slide. The hospital physicians, you know, are there in the hospital pretty much all the time, but they may not be on the same ward where the patient is at all the times. They may be on different wards or different units. So again, if it's good to know at what time they expect to see you, especially when if your family member or other people from your group would like to discuss or have a meeting with that doctor. So I think having some sense of their availability in advance helps this in terms of planning these family meetings, because otherwise the families may come in the morning and the hospital physician may not be available till late in the day, and then feel bad that sometimes the family members are waiting for a long time to be seen by the hospital doctor. So I think, you know, planning these a little bit in advance will help in terms of effective communication, but also avoiding unnecessary delays and waste of the family members' valuable time. A couple of other questions here, and of course the hospital is a very busy place typically. A lot of things are getting done, a lot of tests are being ordered. So having information about what exactly is being done today, what is the reason for doing this test, and what is the result of that test is important. Typically in the morning time, a nurse, you know, or a tech will come and come to the patient's room and is supposed to explain what is planned for today, but sometimes it may not happen in that fashion. So I think if a patient asks what are the tests that are planned for today, and at the end of the day, what are the results of those tests, it kind of helps, again, just having that information as well as the communication piece. Next slide. What about when somebody is going for a surgery or a procedure? Common things to consider as part of the communication with your physician in that setting will be, how long do you expect that I'll be in the hospital after this procedure or surgery? And now overall, there is a push to avoid hospitalization post-surgery, post-procedure. Many a times these things are done as ambulatory procedures. Patients may still come to the hospital, but will go to an ambulatory suite where a procedure will take place. Patient may get monitored for a few hours after the procedure and then will be discharged on the same day from that ambulatory suite. So these are like daytime procedures. And of course, there are still a lot of procedures and surgeries where patients still get admitted. But overall, many procedures are now getting shifted towards ambulatory or a day surgery type of procedure. So knowing again in advance, when do you expect to be discharged from that ambulatory suite or from the hospital, it helps in terms of planning. Knowing whether the procedure is urgent or can it be done electively is helpful. Certain times of the year are of course going to be busier, and there's going to be less availability for of the doctors or the healthcare providers. So holiday time, you know, typically the last 2 weeks in December, a lot of availability of many physicians is limited. So if it's a procedure and is an elective procedure, and then let's just, you know, schedule it after that holiday season. On the other hand, if it's an urgent, then of course you don't have a choice. It has to happen as soon as possible. What to expect in terms of recovery from that procedure is an important question. Many times now patients, especially after when they leave right after the daycare, after the ambulatory surgery, a nurse may call on the next day to kind of find out how the patient is doing. And at that time when they call you, it's good to know what, you know, what you are supposed to expect, how much pain, how much discomfort, any other limitations on the activity. So when the nurse calls you the next day, you can tell him or her whether the recovery is going on as you anticipated, or is it different than what you anticipated. Next slide. So some more questions about, of course, going into the details about the surgery and the procedure. I won't read all of them, but the questions will include how long this procedure or surgery going to last, what kind of anesthesia am I going to receive? Is it going to be a general anesthesia? Will I be completely unconscious, or will I be awake and alert as the procedure takes place? Who actually will be doing the procedure, especially in a teaching hospital such as where I practice. We have a lot of trainees who are, of course, as a part of our institute mission is to train the future generation of physicians and surgeons. But I think from the patient's perspective, it's also important to know that how many of these procedures surgeon or a proceduralist has done in the past, and is it the attending physician who does the procedure, or is it the trainee physician who's doing it? So I think, again, having this information is helpful and provides you more insights in terms of how the system is working. Next slide. So in the next, I guess, maybe a few minutes, I'll just focus on some specific questions about conditions that we commonly see in the field of nephrology or kidney specialty. So hypertension is common. Questions for this will be, do I need any special tests to find out why do I have high blood pressure? Keeping in mind that most patients with hypertension do not have a specific cause for high blood pressure, but there are rare patients where it could be a specific cause, such as some genetic conditions or problems with blood flow circulation to their kidneys. So having that question ready will prompt again your physician to think about, is it a patient who has hypertension without any specific cause, or is it a patient who needs further workup for finding out the cause of high blood pressure. Lifestyle changes, what could be done for hypertension will be another important question. How often should I check my blood pressure if you're checking blood pressure at home? What are my numbers today in the doctor's office, both the upper number, which is known as systolic, and the lower number, which is known as the diastolic? And what should be my target? You know, so if you're telling me today that my numbers are high, then what is the actual target and where should my number be? And that number varies for each patient. So again, knowing that from your doctor, what is the specific number for you will be helpful. Next slide.
Dr. Nagulkar, we are running kind of low on time and we have questions.
Okay.
If you could just maybe a couple more minutes because we have audience questions and we just want to make sure.
I pause there and then let's open for questions. And depending on if these questions are about some specific conditions, I can come back to these slides, the next few slides.
Okay, that sounds great. So one question we have is, if someone does have more questions, but the doctor says it's time for them to move on to their next patient, what should they do?
Yes, that's a great question. I think a few thoughts on that question. One is, of course, if we can avoid that situation altogether by just, you know, having dialogue with the physician right in the beginning of the visit, saying that I'm going to have a few questions, so that as soon as you finish your evaluation, let me have some time so that I can get my questions answered. But of course, that's not always perfect and doesn't happen in the real world. And it's not uncommon to come across a situation where you just have thought about a question, but a physician is running out of time. So I would say a few things you can still ask. One is, of course, are there any other resources that I can tap into to get the information that I'm looking for? And then, are there other ways that I can communicate with your office, such as these electronic tools that I mentioned, as a follow up to the visit? Most physicians would like to accommodate and have the questions answered as part of the visit, but I understand the time constraints can be limiting. But having some kind of other mode of communication, electronic tools, will be helpful to get those questions answered.
Thank you. So another question. Sometimes I have questions after a visit, and I don't want to wait until the next appointment, or I don't want to have to make an entirely new appointment for just one or two questions. What's the best way to communicate with your doctor in between?
Yeah, so I, as a practicing physician, I prefer these questions, and we have the patient online portal available. So it's very frequently patients actually write those questions to me through that secure portal, and those get answered by me through that portal. Patients can also communicate with the office nurse who is also, of course, a valuable team player, and maybe able to answer some of those questions without having the physician inputs. So I think those are some resources to tap into.
Okay, I think this one is kind of about maybe further down in your presentation, but can a urinary tract infection and kidney stones cause kidney damage?
So both these conditions, urine kidney stones and kidney infections, yes, in some patients may be the cause of kidney damage, particularly so if there is going to be a recurrent infection or a recurrent stone formation, or if the stones cause obstruction to the urine flow, that can be a source of kidney damage. And if you have ability to go back to maybe a slide on stone and the infection, I can share that. But if we don't have time, then we can keep going on with the questions.
Probably because I have a couple that are pretty interesting here. One is, does the hospital automatically keep my primary care physician up to date, or is it my responsibility to report back once I'm out?
Yeah, that's a great question. So hospitals typically will send all the information regarding the hospital that happened in the hospitalization to the primary care's office via a fax message or through some of these electronic tools. So physician's office will get an email with all the details about the hospitalization. And again, that's what they're supposed to do. And that works actually very well when the primary care physician is also part of the same hospital system. But sometimes, the primary care physicians may be in a different system than where the patient was hospitalized. And they're still supposed to do the same thing, but at the same time, things can fall through the cracks, so as to say. So I really encourage the patients, and if I give a copy of their hospital, at least a discharge summary with them as they're leaving the hospital, and most hospitals do that, and then that they can carry to their primary care provider's office at the time of next appointment.
Here's one that's interesting here. I already have Googled my symptoms and have a pretty good guess as to what I might have. Should I let my doctor know what I think I have, or is it better to only share the symptoms?
Yeah, so I Again, in my practice, I actually prefer that the patients, are engaged and look up different resources and explain to me what they have found. I also study a rare disease, and I rely actually quite a bit on the patients to describe the symptoms because they can be quite subtle in some of the conditions that I see. But I completely acknowledge that different doctors may have different opinions and practices around this issue. I guess maybe when you're meeting a new physician for the first time, maybe asking that upfront, will it be okay? What resource, if I look up resources and discuss those with you, and also if you have any specific recommendations. So for example, when it comes to kidney disease, there are a lot of great resources out there from foundations and organizations, including American Kidney Fund, and those are very trusted and well-vetted resources. So I think as long as the patient is getting information from a good resource such as this, that will be that actually adds to their overall care.
So here's another question. I'm experiencing pain, but my doctor isn't taking it seriously. After some testing, he always says that I'm fine, but I don't feel fine. What should I do? Should I get a second opinion?
Yeah, so well, I guess first of all, finding out why, what does the physician thinks is the source of pain is important, and just kind of understanding where what tests are already done and what is the current diagnosis. But at the same time, it's not sometimes, there could be disagreement or this discrepancy between the patient's symptoms and the physician's interpretation of the symptom and a specific diagnosis. And in that setting, yes, I think getting a second opinion is one option. Sometimes, of course, just going back to the physician and explaining that the symptom is still ongoing and I'm not getting the relief that I was anticipating, and maybe we should look into something else as treatment or test, may also just help get to that next step. But again, most physicians are quite accepting of the, and should be accepting of the fact that patients are entitled to the second opinions. And also, more importantly, none of us should be under the false impression that we know every patient's body as well as we should. So it's a human body, it's a fascinating system, and sometimes there are limitations that somebody else may be able to diagnose more accurately.
Thank you. So is it effective to communicate with a pharmacist about some of the medications, or should a patient talk to his or her physician?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So there will be some questions about the medications which are, I think, better to address with a physician, such as what is the alternative to this medication? Like, for example, can I do some lifestyle changes as opposed to taking a medication? Because by the time you reach a pharmacist, the prescription is already made. And then the pharmacist is mostly focusing on going over the instructions in terms of when to take the medication, what side effects potentially can take place, so on and so forth. So I think the discussion about whether the medication is the right medication for you, if this medication doesn't work, what is my option, those kind of questions will be more appropriate, I think, for the prescribing provider, meaning the physician. Whereas the questions about, the timing of medication or the some of the side effects to expect, those can be discussed in detail with the pharmacist.
Here's one about surgery. Can I ask my surgeon if they do my surgery at no charge?
Can I ask my surgeon to do my surgery at no charge? I guess why not? You can ask, but maybe I think it'll be different in different situations, and each patient's scenario may be different. But I think, one possibility could be that the patient has a limited health insurance or no insurance, and then the surgeon's fee part may be waived, and some surgeons will do that. I guess no harm in asking. but maybe it will depend on each scenario.
Well, thank you. That will have to be our final question, but thank you so much, Dr. Negrekar, for joining us and leading such an excellent webinar. Let's see. So I just wanted to make an announcement that next month we will have another webinar, Why I Dialyze at Home, Stories from a Kidney Patient and Caregiver, will be held on October 16th and hosted by Nadia Makrushin and Nazar Makrushin. Registration is now open, so please visit kidneyfund.org/webinars for more information. When the webinar closes, please do not close your browser window. You may see a pop-up saying that the webinar has ended. Please close that pop-up and proceed to the webinar evaluation survey. Your feedback helps us make our webinars the best they can be. So thank you so much for joining us, and we hope to see you again.
Thank you.